This presentation will be on upper respiratory tract infections. The slides are made by the Indian Academy of Pediatrics and are available online as a part of the IAPUG teaching module of 2015-16. One of the reasons why this topic has a specific importance, even though not too much from exam point of view, is because it is one of the most commonly seen conditions among children, and hence it's important to understand about the various aspects in which it can present and the treatment. So, like I was saying, it is the most common problem in children aged less than 5 years, and it is normal for a child under 5 years to get 6 to 8 episodes of an upper respiratory tract infection per year. Now, when I say upper respiratory tract, it includes infections of the nasal cavity, throat, nasopharynx, ears, and the sinuses as well. So, if we consider pharyngitis, we can see two different spectrums in this. One is, of course, nasopharyngitis, where the nasal symptoms are more prominent, and tonsillopharyngitis, where the throat symptoms are more predominant. As the name itself suggests, nasopharyngitis, naso, where nasal symptoms are more, which presents typically like a cold, and tonsillopharyngitis, where the throat symptoms are more prominent, and in tonsillopharyngitis, of course, there will be difficulty in swallowing, as well as maybe mild fever. So, if we consider the etiology, most common etiology, of course, remains viral, where rhinoviruses, influenza viruses, para-influenza viruses, coronaviruses and adenoviruses are the most common. Amidst the bacterial spectrum, it is the group A beta hemolytic streptococci as the most common, followed closely by Haemophilus influenza and Clostridium diphtheriae. Now, what's important to keep in mind is H influenza does have vaccine. So, because of good vaccination effort, this has come down. Whereas group A beta hemolytic streptococci remains as an important bacterial cause. So, if you see the clinical presentation, fever, running nose, sore throat, conjunctival conditions, deglutition, pain, and cough, all of these remain cardinal symptoms, where fever is, of course, the most predominant complaint. I've said in the previous videos as well, fever is often the most common complaint with which children are brought to a pediatrician. Now, apart from fever, symptoms of runny nose, sore throat are also common. And based on the symptoms and the history, it is possible to distinguish between a viral and a bacterial etiology. So, before going into the differentiation, just take a look at this image where you can see a gross amount of congestion which is present over the posterior pharyngeal wall in this child. You can see the uvula is markedly congested. The tonsils are enlarged on both sides. Tongue, of course, does appear normal, but a general amount of congestion does remain seen. So, the diagnosis of this with an acute history will remain as acute pharyngitis, and it is a clinical diagnosis. If you come to the viral aspect, that is the viral components, they will almost always have an acute onset with red eyes, rhinorrhea, that is drip, nasal drip will be present, exanthematous lesions will be present, diarrhea will almost always be there. Now, it may be there, it may not be there, but a presence of diarrhea always does point in favor of viral. The presence of cough is something which is important because based on the nature of the cough, whether it is productive, dry or semi-productive itself will lead towards viral. Generally, a dry cough will go towards a viral etiology. Pharyngeal exudates and lymphadenopathy, of course, will be rare. But a viral etiology will sometimes involve more than one mucous membrane. So, that is another point to keep in mind. Now, if you see bacterial etiologies, it will also be acute in onset, but there will be throat pain, nasal discharge will be less compared to viral, and the cough will also be comparatively less compared to a viral etiology. The features, of course, will remain more in favor of pharyngeal congestion, exudatic lesions, patchy tonsils, a white patch over the tonsil, or tender cervical lymphadenopathy, all of which goes in favor of bacterial. Of course, the complications of these pharyngitis can, of course, go for retropharyngeal abscess, where it will remain a cause of fever of unknown origin, peritonsillar abscess, otitis media might develop, mastoiditis and sinusitis are more rare suppurative complications, whereas non-suppurative complications, of course, remain as acute rheumatic fever and acute glomerulonephritis, the reason being it is a sequel of group A beta hemolytic streptococci. And like I mentioned in the initial slides with that photo, the diagnosis is almost always clinical, and investigations such as a complete blood count, ESR and CRP might help but it has a comparatively low predictive value. The diagnosis is clinical, clinical, and always clinical. Now, for group A beta hemolytic streptococci, the gold standard investigation is throat culture, throat swab culture is the gold standard test. Rapid antigen detection tests are also available, but it's important to note that the ASO titers have no role in diagnosis of acute pharyngitis because it takes several weeks to come positive, and the role of ASO is more limited towards rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease. So ASO can prove that the person has had the group A beta hemolytic streptococci in the past, but it cannot give a current infection. Of course, the treatment for pharyngitis remains supportive. Rest antipyretics will help. Normal saline nasal drops do help, and antihistamines might be helpful. So if you see a typical prescription for a pharyngitis, of course, we will give paracetamol as per the weight of the child. The dosage of paracetamol is 15 mg per kg per dose. As far as the normal saline nasal drops are concerned, it generally goes under the brand name of Nasivion S. One point I would like to highlight, though it is normal saline, the trade name of Nasivion goes in favor of oxymetazoline, which of course has a risk of septal perforation in children. So it's always essential to ensure you do cross-check the prescriptions before giving. The normal saline nasal drops can be given Q6 hourly, so 4 times a day it is to be given in the child. Apart from that, when it comes to the choice of antihistamines, predominantly what we go for is either cetirizine or CPM in various combinations. Of course, various cough mixtures do have various combinations, but the dosage of CPM remains 0.35 mg per kg per day. And the dosage of cetirizine varies age-wise. So 6 months to 2 years, it remains 2.5 mg OD. I'll just rewrite it to make it a little more legible. So we were talking about the dosage of cetirizine. So if you consider 6 months to 2 years, it remains as 2.5 mg OD. That is once a day. 2 years to 6 years, you can give 2.5 mg twice a day, and greater than 6 years you can go 5 to 10 mg either once a day or twice a day, because it is comparatively safe depending on the age and the weight of the child. And there is no role for a specific antimicrobial treatment for viral pharyngitis, and group A beta hemolytic streptococci infecting the throat, that is pharyngitis of bacterial origin, is also self-limiting. But the role of antibiotics here is very important because it goes to prevent the morbidity, mortality, and the complications. In such children, penicillin, of course, will remain the drug of choice, but due to allergies to penicillin and due to resistance, the alternative which we have come up with is always amoxicillin, and now in more recent times, amoxiclav. Though many lectures are there about the rational use of antibiotics, it's always better to aggressively treat a pharyngitis to prevent the complications, and the dosage will remain 40 to 50 milligram per kg per day. And alternative drugs like erythromycin, azithromycin can also be given for a pharyngitis. And a specific indication for tonsillectomy remains if 7 or more infections of the tonsils per year as per the latest guidelines. Now, coming to ASOM, it's of course, otitis media, of course, is defined as inflammation of the middle ear. And children are more prone for ASOM because the eustachian tubes remain communicating open between the throat and the ear. And these communications are straight and short too. So this acts as a predisposing factor. Now, if you consider the types of otitis media, we classify it as acute, where it is of acute history. CSOM, where there is a chronic suppuration and there is also an associated lesion in the tympanic membrane. And recurrent otitis media, where there are multiple episodes of AOM, where it is either 3 or more in 6 months or 4 or more in a year, either of which fall under the criteria for recurrent otitis media. So if you consider the etiology, we classify it again based on organism as bacterial, viral. And amidst bacterial, we have strep pneumonia, H. influenza, and Moraxella catarrhalis as the most common organisms in the same order. And viruses causing otitis media being respiratory syncytial virus as well as influenza virus. Very rare causes of otitis media in immunocompromised. will remain, of course, fungal. So candida is a very rare cause, but it's seen only in immunocompromised conditions like SCID or in a severely affected HIV child. And diagnosis of IOM is clinical. It's done by examination and it is done with the presence of an otoscope. So using the otoscope, if you examine the ear, you can see a tympanic membrane that looks reddish, more than normal, more inflamed, more tense, and a typical description of this is an angry look. So an angry looking tympanic membrane is diagnostic towards an otitis media of acute nature. And the major complications of which include pyogenic meningitis and deafness because of continuous accumulation of pus within the middle ear and spread of this pus into the intracranium. Of course, the treatment remains as amoxicillin plus clavulanic acid in the latest update. So the treatment is amoxiclav, and the dosage has changed in recent times since this presentation was made. The dosage is now given as 80 mg per kg per day as an outpatient basis, and third generation cephalosporins like ceftriaxone can be given if the child is extremely sick and warranting an admission. So ceftriaxone can be given at 75 mg per kg per day if it is an IV required for the patient. If it is oral, amoxiclav at 80 mg per kg per day is more than sufficient. The treatment is to be continued for the entire course of 10 days to ensure there is no complications or chronicity, and paracetamol is given as per weight of the child to ensure there is no pain and there is no fever spikes for the child. It is important to keep in mind that there is no role for local antibiotics in ASOM because the tympanic membrane is very much intact and the suppuration is within. So putting topical ear drops from outside will have zero effect whatsoever. There are many cases what we encounter in office practice where the child takes 2 or 3 days of antibiotics and is stopped by the parents because they think the child has become better. So these fall under the criteria of what we call as partially treated or untreated cases. And this can result in middle ear effusion. And this middle ear effusion is what will give rise to deafness. To avoid this, as per protocol, it is recommended to do a tympanometry every 2 weeks until it is completely resolved. And collaboration with the ENT department is a must to ensure that this is followed. However, in practice, it is difficult and it can be avoided by merely completing the course of antibiotics. Now, coming to sinusitis, in children, we all know that maxillary and ethmoid sinuses are fully developed at birth. The sphenoid sinus developed by the 3rd year of life and the frontal sinus by 7 to 8 years. So, given that these sinuses are present at various age groups, infection of these sinuses is also quite common and can be affected during a nasopharyngitis episode. So, just to know the anatomy of the sinuses, we know that the frontal sinuses are situated here as shown in the diagram. Ethmoidal sinuses are present here and maxillary sinuses are present here. And we all know that the maxillary sinus is comparatively larger compared to the ethmoid, and ethmoid is smaller when compared to the frontal sinus. So, on water view x-ray, if you do consider this, you can make out that the frontal sinuses are present in this child, and the left sided frontal sinus does show some collection and haziness as compared to, the right side shows some haziness as compared to the left side. So, some amount of haziness you can make out there, what is shown in blue. Now, secondly, if you do consider the ethmoid sinus, which I will now highlight in green, the ethmoid sinus remains quite okay here on the right side. But the left side, again, it is okay, but somewhat you can notice a dark colored opacity here in the middle, and you can notice some connection there. And of course, maxillary sinus remains perfectly fine on the left side, but the right side you can also notice here some collections, what I'm highlighting in green. So, as a result of which, this is predominantly a right-sided sinusitis involving the maxillary sinus the most, but showing early stages of involvement in both the frontal as well as ethmoidal sinus. So, clinically, it will present as nasal congestion with a purulent discharge, with a history of fever, cough, and typical history of halitosis. So, halitosis does go in favor of a sinusitis also as a differential diagnosis along with adenoiditis. But unlike in adults, headache and facial pain are rarer complaints in children. Of course, in younger children, because their inability to complain of headaches is there. But even later on, the severity of which will not be as severe as that of an adult. The treatment for sinusitis, of course, remains similar like pharyngitis. It remains as amoxiclav for 40 mg per kg per day, or severe cases requiring admission, third generation cephalosporins such as ceftriaxone. And treatment must be given for a full course of 14 days or for 1 week beyond symptoms resolution to ensure that the sinusitis is completely cured. It is important not to stop the treatment just when symptomatic relief is given. On that note, I conclude this short presentation on upper respiratory tract infections and hope you all were able to revise the important aspects of it. I thank you all for listening to the presentation and hope you tune into the next video also. Thank you.